This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book: Success and How He Won It by E. Werner. Chapter 1. It was growing late in the afternoon, yet the principal church of the capital was still densely filled. From the numbers present, the beautiful floral decorations of the altar, and the long line of handsome equipages waiting without, it was evident that the ceremony about to be celebrated had awakened interest and sympathy far and wide. As usual on such occasions, when the sacredness of the place forbids any distinct utterance of curiosity or other feeling, the spectators found vent for the restlessness of expectation by whispering, and the gathering together of heads in little groups, and by an eager attention to all that was going on in the neighborhood of the vestry. A general exclamation of satisfaction was heard when its doors opened, and as the first tones of the organ pealed forth, the wedding party appeared. A numerous and brilliant company thronged round the bridal pair at the altar. Rich uniforms, heavy velvet and satin dresses, airy fabrics of lace, flowers, and diamonds, waved and rustled confusedly in a truly dazzling splendor. The aristocracy of birth and the aristocracy of finance, represented each by its most distinguished members, had met, as it seemed, to enhance the prestige of the marriage ceremony. To the right of the bride, first among the guests, stood a tall and stately officer, whose uniform and various orders bore witness to a long military career. His bearing was simple and dignified, suited to the solemnity of the occasion, and yet it seemed as though, behind the set gravity of the features, there lurked a something at variance with so joyful an event. His look was singularly gloomy as it rested on the young couple, and when he turned from them and glanced through the crowded church, an expression of suppressed pain or anger passed over the proud face, and the firmly closed lips trembled slightly. Opposite him, and next to the bridegroom, stood a gentleman in plain clothes, also advanced in years, and also, as it appeared, closely related to the young people. But neither his lavish display of brilliance in watch, rings, and pin, nor the extreme self-importance of his bearing could procure for him a shade of that distinction which his opposite neighbor possessed in so eminent a degree. His whole appearance was decidedly ordinary, not to say vulgar, and even the unconcealed triumph now illumining his countenance could set no other impress on it. The triumph was indeed great with which he gazed on the bridal pair, and he looked down the aisle on the closely packed rows of chairs and on all the bright assembly with the satisfaction of one who, after long striving, sees and welcomes the fulfillment of his aims and hopes. Clearly no shadow troubled his gladness at the event now to be solemnest. But of all present, these two men alone appeared to take a deep interest in what was passing. Least of all were the principal actors moved. The most unsympathizing of the guests, the greatest stranger, could hardly have shown a more complete indifference to the solemn act about to be performed than these two who, in a few minutes, would be forever united. The bride was about 19, and of undeniable beauty, but around her there seemed to reign a sort of icy chill, which ill became the hour and the place. The light from the altar candles played on the thick folds of her white satin dress, shone in the diamonds of her costly ornaments, but it fell on a face which, with the beauty of marble, seemed for the time being at least a time when the most frigid calm might naturally yield and kindle to have acquired also a statue-like coldness and fixity. The flaxen hue of the heavy tresses, on which her myrtle wreath rested, contrasted strangely with the well-marked eyebrows and dark, almost black eyes, uplifted to the priest but once or twice during the entire ceremony. The pale, regular features, shaded on either side by her flowing veil, bore that distinctive mark of breeding which birth and birth alone can give. Indeed, this high-bred air was the chief characteristic of her appearance. It showed itself not only in her delicate and noble features, but was so plainly stamped on her carriage and entire being, that all other qualities, some perhaps striking even deeper root, were by it overshadowed and held in the background. A young lady fitted only, it would seem, for the higher spheres of life, never to be brought in contact with those possible men and things which perchance may exist in its lower phases. Yet, in spite of all this, Something in the dark eyes betrayed more energy and character than are usually found in a lady of fashion, and possibly the present hour was one to call such energy and such strength of nature to the front. As the ceremony proceeded, the gentleman in uniform to her right, and three younger officers who stood behind him, gazed ever more intently, ever more anxiously, at her face. It remained, however, calm and impassible as it had been from the first. The bridegroom at her side was a young man of about 28, one of those not very uncommon individuals who seem expressly created for the gilded surroundings of a salon, who there alone find their significance, obtain their triumphs, and pass their lives. Blamelessly correct in mien and toilette, his whole being seemed to denote the extremity of languor. His features, fine and agreeable in themselves, bore an expression of apathy so complete, of so boundless an indifference to all and everything, that they lost their charm for the observer. He had led his bride to the altar with the air of a man leading a lady to the place destined for her in any ordinary assembly, and he now stood by her, and held her hand, in precisely the same apathetic fashion. Neither the importance of the step he was about to take, nor the beauty of the woman he was there to wed, seemed to make the slightest impression on him. The priest's discourse came to an end, and he proceeded to the actual marriage service. Loud and clear, his voice rang through the church as he asked Arthur Berkow and the Baroness Eugenie Maria Anna von Windegg-Babenow if they consented to take each other for man and wife. Again the officer's face twitched nervously, and he darted a look almost of hatred across to the other side. Next minute, the double yes was spoken, and one of the oldest, proudest of aristocratic names had been exchanged for the simple plebeian Berkow. Hardly was the service over, and the last word of the concluding benediction uttered, when the gentleman wearing the handsome brilliance pressed hastily forwards, evidently intending to embrace the newly married lady with much ostentation. Before, however, he could carry out his project, the officer stepped between them. Quickly, as though claiming an indisputable right to be first, he took the young bride in his arms, but the lips which touched her forehead were cold, and his face as he bent over her remained hidden a few seconds from all around. When he raised it, his expression had changed to one of calm and quiet dignity. "Courage, father, it had to be." These words, intelligible to him alone, were breathed so low as to be barely audible, but they gave him back his self-command. Again he pressed his daughter to him with a wistful tenderness, which had in it something like a prayer for pardon. Then he left her free, giving her over to the now inevitable embrace of the other, who had waited with visible impatience, and would no longer be deprived of his right to salute his dear daughter-in-law. She certainly made no attempt to withdraw herself from him, for the eyes of the whole church were upon her. Standing motionless, with no shade of disturbance on her beautiful face, she only raised her eyes to him, but in her look there was a haughtiness so unapproachable, so icy a repulse of that which could not be openly refused, that she made herself understood even here. Somewhat disconcerted, her father-in-law changed his vehement demonstration of affection to an attitude of respectful politeness, and the embrace which immediately followed was in reality little more than a form, his arms touching nothing more substantial than the flowing drapery of her bridal veil. The new relation's assurance, though certainly far from small, had yet not held its ground before that glance. Young Berkow made things easier for his father-in-law. Something passed between them which looked like shaking hands, but in truth, his white kid gloves hardly came into contact with those of the Baron. It seemed, however, fully to suffice them both. He then offered his arm to his young wife and led her away. The bride's satin train rustled over the marble steps and down the aisle as the two passed out, followed by the guests in gay procession. Shortly afterwards, the carriages outside were heard to drive away one by one. The church was soon emptied. Some pressed to the doors to see the departing visitors once more. Some hastened out to give vent to all their important observations and reflections with regard to the toilette, bearing, and appearance of the young couple, and those nearly connected with them. In less than 10 minutes, the vast place was empty and deserted. Only the evening glow shone through the tall windows and flooded the altar and great altarpiece with its crimson light, so that the figures on the old golden background seemed quickened into life. Fanned by a current of air, the candles flared unsteadily, and the flowers, lying crushed and trampled underfoot on the ground where they had been so prodigally strewn, breathed forth their dying odors. What better end could the poor flowers serve amid such a blaze of jewels, on so high a festival as this, when the daughter of an old baronial house had been given in marriage to the son of the city millionaire? The carriages had already reached the Windegg mansion, and life and movement were beginning to circulate through the gaily lighted rooms. In the principal salon, radiantly illuminated by countless wax lights, the young bride stood leaning on her husband's arm, cold, beautiful, and haughty, as she had stood at the altar an hour before, and received the congratulations of the eager friends pressing round her with their good wishes. Had she really set the seal on her own happiness by that yes she had so lately spoken? The dark shadow still resting on her father's brow might perhaps have given the fitting answer. End of the chapter. Chapter 2. Well, thank heaven, we are in order at last, but it was high time, for they may be here in another quarter of an hour. I have given the people up on the hill full instructions. As soon as the carriage is visible on the heights, the first salute is to be given. Why, my dear director, you are all fire and excitement today. Keep some of your strength for the important moment of the reception. Indeed, your present position as Master of the Ceremonies and Lord High Chamberlain. Spare your pleasantries, gentlemen, said the director with some vexation in his tone. I wish one of you had been honored with this confounded post. I have had enough of it. The entire staff of officials connected with the great Birkau mines was assembled in full dress at the foot of the terrace running before the chateau. Built in the style of an elegant and modern villa, with a handsome facade, great plate glass windows, and a fine entrance, the house produced a striking effect, which was still further heightened by the tasteful gardens surrounding it on all sides, and looking specially beautiful today in their fete-like dress. The conservatories had evidently been stripped of their richest treasures for the decoration of the steps, balconies, and terraces. The rarest and most precious plants, so seldom brought in contact with the outer air, unfolded here their wealth of color and perfumed the air with their sweet scents. On the broad lawns stood fountains, throwing high into the air their sparkling waters, and round them, most carefully cultivated, bloomed all the native beauties of spring in her first awakening. At the chief entrance a lofty triumphal arch was reared, all decked with flags and garlands, and the great gates thrown wide open were also twined with flowers. I have had enough of it, repeated the director, stepping up to the other gentleman. Herr Birkau demands the most brilliant reception possible, and thinks he has done everything when he gives us unlimited credit. As to the goodwill of the people, he never takes that into account. Well and good, if we had the working men of 20 years ago to deal with. When, for once in a way, there came an off day then, any kind of a holiday with a dance in the evening, one need never be anxious about the way they would cheer. But now, what with passive indifference on the one hand, and open hostility on the other, they were very near refusing to give any reception at all to their young master and his bride. If you go back to town tomorrow, Herr Schaefer, it would do no harm in your report of our festive doings to let a hint drop of the state of things. It seems they either do not or will not know of it there. That I certainly shall not, returned the other. Do you care to listen to our respected governor's very polite language when he has to hear of anything unpleasant? As for me, I prefer at such times to retire to the greatest possible distance from his august person. The others laughed. It hardly seemed as though the absent master were held in much veneration among them. So he really has brought about the grand marriage, began the chief engineer. He has given himself trouble enough about it. It will be some compensation for that patent of nobility which has been hitherto so persistently denied him, and for which, above all else, his soul yearns. He has, at least, the triumph of seeing that the noble old houses feel no prejudice against him as a plain commoner. The windigs are willing to ally themselves with him. Herr Schaefer shrugged his shoulders. They had no choice left. The embarrassed state of the family affairs is no secret in the city. I doubt if it has been an easy thing to the proud baron to give up his daughter on such a speculation. The windigs have always been, not only among the oldest, but also among the haughtiest of the aristocracy, but even pride must bend to a bitter necessity. One thing is certain, this grand connection will cost us a famous sum of money, said the director. The baron is sure to have made his conditions. Besides, I really do not see the object of all these sacrifices. I could understand it if they were made with a view to buying rank and a title for a daughter, but Herr Arthur will be just as plebeian as before, in spite of his wife's ancient lineage. Do you think so? I would wager not. They will grant to the husband of a Baroness Windegg Babenow, to the Baron's son-in-law, all that his father has striven for in vain, and as for the latter, in his daughter-in-law's salon nothing can hinder him from meeting all the people who have hitherto held him at a respectful distance. Don't tell me. The governor knows well enough what this marriage will bring him in, and so he can afford to pay something for the cost of it. One of the officials, a fair young man with a tight-fitting dress coat and irreproachable gloves, here thought fit to put in an observation. For my part, I don't understand why the newly married pair should make their wedding trip to our solitudes, and not rather to the land of poetry, to Italy. The chief engineer laughed out loud. What an idea, Wilberg! Poetry in a match like this, between money and a title. Besides, wedding tours to Italy have become so general that they probably appear vulgar to Herr Birkow. At such times the aristocracy retire to their estates, and we must be aristocratic before everything. I fear there is another and a deeper reason, said the director. They suspect that the young fellow would continue in Rome or Naples, the same sort of life he has led in the capital for the last few years, and it is high time to put an end to it. His expenditure latterly might be reckoned by tens of thousands. Most springs may be exhausted, and Herr Arthur was in the right way for trying this little experiment on his father. Schaefer's thin lips curled sarcastically. His father has always encouraged him in it, he only reaps what he has sown. Perhaps you are right, it will be easier for him to get used to the yoke up here in these wilds, and to learn to obey his wife. I am only afraid she may not fulfill her mission with much enthusiasm. It certainly is not a very enviable one. Do you think she has been forced to marry him? Asked Wilberg eagerly. Nonsense forced, the thing is not done in a tragic way nowadays. She has simply yielded to reasonable advice and to a clear insight into the position of affairs. I have no doubt this marriage of convenience will turn out tolerably well. They do mostly. The fair Herr Wilberg, who clearly had a leaning to the tragical, shook his head with a melancholy air. It may be not. If, in the heart of the young wife, true love should awake later, if another. Good heavens, Hartmann, cannot you lead your men farther off? You are covering us with a perfect cloud of dust, you and your regiment. The young miner, to whom these words were addressed, and who was passing at the head of about 50 of his comrades, gave a contemptuous glance at the carefully appointed dress of the speaker, and another at the sandy carriage road, where the miner's heavy shoes certainly had raised some dust. "Right about face," he cried, and the column wheeled round with almost military precision, taking the direction indicated. "What a bear that Hartmann is," said Wilberg, fanning the dust from his coat with his handkerchief. Not a word of excuse for his awkwardness. Right about face, in a tone of command, like a general at the head of his troops. And then he takes so much upon himself. If his father had not put in his word, he would have forbidden the girl Martha to recite my poem composed for the bride's reception, my poem which I "Have already read aloud to everybody," finished the chief engineer in an undertone to the director. If only it were a little shorter, but he is right, it was audacious of Hartman to wish to forbid it. You should not have posted him and his people just on this spot. There is no sort of welcome to be looked for from them. They are the most rebellious fellows on the whole works. The director shrugged his shoulders. Yes, but then they are the finest men. I have stationed all the others in the village, and on the road, the elite of our people ought to be at the chief entrance, the post of honor. On an occasion like this, one wishes to make a show of one's belongings. The young miner who was thus being discussed had in the meantime stationed his comrades round the triumphal arch and placed himself at their head. The director was right, they were fine fellows, but they were all surpassed by their leader who towered high above them. He had a powerful, well-knit frame, this Hartman, and he looked to full advantage in his dark miner's dress. His face would hardly have been called handsome, if judged by the strict laws of symmetry. The brow might have seemed too low, the lips too full, the lines not noble enough, but those sharply cut and well-marked features were certainly no ordinary ones. The light curly hair lay thick on the broad, massive forehead, and a wavy brown beard encircled the lower part of the face, the manly bronze of which did not betray that it was so often deprived of air and sunshine. His parted lips had a defiant look, and in the rather somber expression of his blue eyes lay a something which can hardly be defined, but which impressed itself at once on ordinary minds, and was respected by them as the sure token of a superior mind. His whole appearance was that of energy incarnate, and however little sympathy his stiff, unbending bearing might excite, it yet commanded attention at the first glance. An older man who, although wearing the miner's dress, did not appear to belong to the working men, drew near now, accompanied by a young girl, and came close up to the group. "Good day to you. Here we are ready to take our part. How do things go, Ulrich? Are you all in order?" Ulrich assented shortly, while the others returned the old man's greeting with a hearty, "Good day, Manager Hartman," and the looks of most of them turned on his young companion. The girl was about 20, and very comely. She wore the holiday costume peculiar to the locality, and it became her well. Rather below the middle height, her head hardly reached to the gigantic Hartman's shoulder. Her fresh young face, with its blooming cheeks and clear blue eyes, a little sunburnt and crowned with thick dark plaits, had strength in it as well as attractiveness. She had made a movement, as if to offer her hand to the young man, but he stood with his arms folded, and she let it fall quickly. The manager noticed this, and looked sharply at them both. "We are out of humor because we could not have our own way for once?" he asked. "Never mind, Ulrich, it does not happen often, but when you push matters too far, your father must speak a word of authority. If I had anything to say about Martha, I should certainly have spoken out pretty plainly," declared Ulrich decidedly, and a dark look fell upon the splendid bouquet in the girl's hand, which certainly owed its origin to a hothouse. "I believe you," said the old man equably, "it would be exactly like you. For the present, however, she is my niece and has to conform to my wishes. But what is the matter with your arch up there? The great flagstaff is drooping. You must bind it up more firmly, or the whole concern will be tumbling down, wreaths and all." Ulrich, to whom this warning was specially addressed, looked up indifferently at the wreaths in danger, but made no attempt to come to their rescue. "Don't you hear?" repeated his father impatiently. "I thought I was hired to work in the mine, and not here at a triumphal arch. Is not it enough that we should have to mount guard in this place? Let those who built the thing set it to rights again. Can't you forget the old tune for one day?" cried the old man angrily. "Well then, one of you go up and see to it." The miners all looked at Ulrich, waiting for a sign of assent from him. As none came, they did not stir. One man only made a move as though he would respond to the summons. The young leader turned silently and looked at him. It was but a single glance from the imperious blue eyes, but it had the effect of command. The man stepped back at once, and no other hand was raised to help. "I wish it would fall on your obstinate heads," cried the manager hotly, as he mounted with quite youthful activity and tied up the flagstaff himself. "Perhaps that would teach you how to behave on such a day as this. You have spoilt Lawrence already amongst you. He used to be worth something, but now he only does what his lord and master Ulrich directs. Ought we to be so overjoyed that a new set of fine masters is coming?" said Ulrich in a low tone. "I should have thought we had had enough of the old." The manager, still busy with the flag, luckily did not hear this speech, but the young girl who had stood silent on one side turned hastily and cast an anxious look upwards. "Ulrich, for my sake." At this injunction the defiant young miner held his peace, but his features did not soften by a shade. The girl remained standing before him. She seemed to hesitate, having something to say and not liking to say it. At last she spoke in a low tone, half questioning, half entreating. "So you really will not come to the fete this evening?"
"No."
"Ulrich." "Let me be, Martha. You know I can't bear your dancing nonsense." Martha stepped back quickly, her red lips pouting, and a glistening tear in her eyes, which sprang even more from anger than from wounded feeling at his unfriendly reply. Ulrich either did not notice it, or did not care. Indeed, he seemed to trouble himself but little about her. Without wasting another word, the girl turned her back on him and crossed over to the other side. The eyes of the young fellow, who just before had been willing to help with the flag, followed her intently. Evidently, he would have given much that the invitation should have been addressed to him. He, assuredly, would not have rejected it so cavalierly. In the meantime, the manager had come down and was reviewing his work with much satisfaction, when the first volley burst forth from the hill opposite, followed at short intervals by another and another. As was natural, these signs that the expected visitors were approaching at last produced some excitement. The gentlemen, assembled out yonder, became suddenly animated. The director hurriedly inspected all the preparations for the last time. The chief engineer and Herr Schaefer buttoned their gloves, and Wilberg rushed over to Martha, probably to ask for the 20th time whether she were sure she knew his verses and would not endanger his triumph as a poet by inopportune shyness. Even the miners betrayed some interest in the young and, as it was said, beautiful bride of their future master. More than one drew in his belt and pressed his hat more firmly on his head. Ulrich alone stood quite unmoved, erect and disdainful as before, and did not even cast a glance over at the other side. But the reception, prepared with so much thought and care, was to turn out differently from what had been hoped and expected. A cry of horror from the manager, who was now standing outside the great arch, drew all eyes in that direction, and what they saw was certainly terrible enough. End of the chapter. Chapter 3. Down the steep road which led from the village came, or rather flew, a carriage, the horses of which, startled probably by the salutes fired, had shaken off all control and were careering wildly down the hill. The carriage rocked to and fro on the uneven ground, and was in imminent danger, either of being thrown down the precipitous incline to the right, or of being dashed to pieces against the great trees which bordered the road on the other side. The coachman seemed to have lost all presence of mind. He had let fall the reins, and was clinging desperately to his seat, while from the hill behind the gunners, prevented by the trees from seeing the accident they had brought about, crashed forth report after report, spurring the terrified animals on and on in their mad course. What the fearful issue must be was only too plainly visible. At the bridge below, a catastrophe would be inevitable. The people assembled before the house did what crowds mostly do on such occasions. They screamed, ran helplessly hither and thither, but it occurred to no one to give that practical help which was so urgently needed. In that moment upon which everything depended, not one, even among the miners, had the courage or the quick wit to rush forwards. Yes, there was a single exception, one man who preserved his self-possession. To take in the whole danger at a glance, to thrust aside his father and comrades, and to spring out from among them, was for Ulrich the work of an instant. In three bounds he had reached the bridge. A scream of horror from Martha rang out after him too late. He had already thrown himself before the horses, and had grasped the reins.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.